Welcome to Dental Board Sunday. When we look at the final x-ray and are confident enough to say it will last long is because we have maintained the working length and working width correct. Hi, I'm Dr. Rohit Sharma and today we are going to see how to determine working length of the tooth correctly. Before determining working length, there are two pre-requirements we should do. Firstly, get straight line SS. After SS preparation, remove the dentine triangle in the coronal segment. This can be achieved by pre-flaring. Pre-flaring and intentional relocating the coronal 1/3 of the canal is a strategic decision. We can observe the handle position of the smaller size instrument to see if they are upright and paralleling the long axis of the tooth, or if they are skewed off axis. When the handle of the file is upright or on the long axis of the tooth, then we are able to confirm the both the coronal and radicular straight line SS. However, when the handle of the initial instrument is off the long axis of the tooth, then the triangle of the dentine must be removed to upright the file handle and position it on axis. Pre-flaring offers us some advantages like decrease the effect of the canal curvature, it improves the straight line SS, avoid error in working length and allows us to better visualize. Second thing, we should flatten the curves so that we can reproduce the working length every time, especially in fractured tooth, but some patients have crown over the tooth and in that scenario we cannot do anything. Now, let's have a look at anatomic tooth structure. In endodontic procedure, we try to get to end of the root and that where apical foramina lies. Apical foramen is main apical opening of the root canal which may be located away from anatomic or radiographic apex. Apical constriction, minor apical diameter, is apical portion of the root canal having narrowest diameter. It is usually 0.5 to 1 mm short of the apical foramen. The minor diameter avoidance apically to foramen, that is major diameter. Cementodentinal junction is the region where the cementum and dentine are united. It is not always necessary that CDJ always coincide with apical constriction. Location of CDJ ranges from 0.5 to 3 mm short of anatomic apex. So, working length is the distance from the coronal reference point to the apical constriction at which canal preparation and obturation should terminate. So, determining the apical foramina is utmost important because it gives us knowledge how far we have to instrument the canal. It affects degree of pain and discomfort which patient will experience following the appointment by virtue of over and under instrumentation. If placed within correct limits, it plays an important role in determining the success of the treatment. Failure to accurately determine and maintain working length may result in length being over than normal, which will lead to postoperative pain, prolonged healing time, and lower success rate because of incomplete regeneration of cementum, periodontal ligament, and alveolar bone. When working length is made short of apical constriction, it may cause persistent discomfort because of incomplete cleaning and underfilling. Apical leakage may occur into uncleaned and unfilled space short of apical constriction. It may support continued existence of viable bacteria and contributes to the periradicular lesion and thus poor success rate. Once apical stop is calculated, monitor the working length periodically because working length may change as curved canal is straightened. Now, let's have a look on another important fact and sometimes forgotten for proper cleaning and shaping, that is working width. It means how much apical end should be enlarged before obturation. The minimum initial working width corresponds to the initial apical file size which binds at working length. The maximum final working width corresponds to the master apical file size. Here question arises, why we want to enlarge the width of the canal? Reasons are, we want to remove the microorganism from the canal mechanically. It increases the working area for better irrigation. It helps to remove the pulp tissue completely and facilitates a sound apical stop so as to achieve a three-dimensional seal. There are basically two guidelines which we consider sufficient for instrumentation. First, enlarge the root canal at least 3 sizes beyond the first instrument that binds the canal. Secondly, enlarge the canal until it is clean, which is indicated by white dentinal shaving on the instrument flutes. But these guidelines are not the sole criteria in all the cases. Color of the dentinal shaving is not indication of presence of infected dentin. Root canal should be enlarged regardless of the initial working width. The main aim should be to remove the canal irregularities of the dentin so as to make the canal wall smooth. Let's discuss one clinical situation. If there is one long oval canal in premolar, how would you prepare this canal for obturation? If you use small file, then more than 50% of the canal would be left unprepared and will lead to failure. If you use big file, it will cut all the dentin around the canal and will lead to weakening of the canal wall and damage the periodontium. So it cannot be the solution. Solution is, consider it as two small canals and then prepare it accordingly. There are few factors which affect the final size of the working width, like whether root canal is vital or non-vital, is there any periapical pathology or root resorption, canal configuration like C-shaped canal, bayonet canals, etc., presence or absence of the isthmus. I think we have enough theoretical knowledge. In next video, we will see how to measure working length for doing cleaning and shaping. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe our channel to watch other useful videos.